big round of applause for Manini, for Mr. Vivek Vaswani, for Nilakshi, for everyone who has come here, for you guys as well. Let's have a big round of applause. So I'm just going to start off with Media Connect. As he mentioned, it is just not about an actor. It is just not about directors. It is just not about script writers. But in the media and entertainment industry, there are so many different fields. You know, that when we come to colleges and to study, we just want to be a director. We want to make a film. But it's just not limited to that. In this session, what we want to address is, what is art direction? You know, how is it different from any form of other creative element that goes into the process called filmmaking? Now, if I as an art director, if I'm Sanjay Gupta, I come to you and I want to make a film which is Kabil and which has a blind guy. I want to set up his room. You have to visualize a lot of things. I mean, you have to think of the elements, what you're going to put, what you're not going to put. So explain the entire process that goes in, I mean, through your mind, and how your team helps you out with, and obviously help explain the process, how you made a highway such as lovely movie and visually appealing, same with Tamasha. So explain the entire journey that you go through with every film, the amount you invest in each film. What are the challenges you face in terms of time, in terms of production cost, budget, and all these things? Address all these things. And maybe we will have a few questions from the audience while we are doing these sessions if they don't understand. But I just want to understand, how many of you all want to make films? Okay, so you all want to make films as in you all want to be a director? You all want to write? You all want to act? Okay, the corner guy is raising his hands for all three things. Good, yeah. How many of you all want to get into art direction? Okay, that's 10%, I think. Good.
Not a bad number.
Not a bad number, yes. So Manini is also going to help you guys who want to get into filmmaking, is how y'all as directors should think, should visualize your film, which is very important. It's just not about that character. Vivek Vaswani will also help in elaborating the production aside from the director's aspect, from the writer's aspect, everything. He would touch upon all those points. But she will help y'all how to think about, even if you're making a short film of 5 minutes, it is, even if you're making the film inside a small room, what are the elements you should put? What are the, you know, primary details that you should think about while making that film to make it a little hatke, a little outstanding? You know, it's not just about, okay, I have a room ready, I have my hostel room ready, and I should just start and start going to shoot and, you know, end it, edit it, and complete it. It's also about the entire process. So, Manini.
Hi guys. This is quite overwhelming because suddenly I get this call and he's like, come speak to people, mostly college students or people who want to enter the industry. And I know when I was there, and I feel I was much smarter back then than I am right now. And I'm really scared of you guys, because when you don't have a set of rules already in your head, because you've been working for some time, your mind is open right now. You don't have rules. You haven't started working. This is the time then where you ask the right questions, where you're much smarter than all of us. So go easy on me and you can ask whatever you want to. And I would like to start with where I started, because I did not plan to go into art direction at all. In fact, when I was doing my graduation, I graduated with English Lit and Geography. Before that, I was doing Science. I did my plus two in Science. Then I got into English Lit and Geography. And after that, I had thought, my plan in life at that point was to get into National Geographic and make documentaries. I wanted to direct documentaries. That's what I wanted to do. And that's why I had applied in Symbiosis. I was studying direction. Art direction was definitely something which I had not even thought about. Planned was way further down that lane. I'd never even thought about it. During our third semester, we had a professor called Ajit Dwara. He is a professor with FTII also, if you guys know, I don't know. But he used to take a couple of classes in our third semester for a couple of weeks here and there. And he was probably one of those professors that make you want to come back. And that was one class I never missed. And he was teaching us French Noir, that era. So he showed us a couple of films in the beginning. And we were supposed to write papers on that. So when I wrote my first paper, which was on La Ventura, so he read the paper and he's supposed to mark it and give it to us. And then we start watching another film and we discuss it in the class and we go back to the room and write our papers and come back again. So when I gave my paper about La Ventura, he called me up and he told me later after the class that somehow a direction student was only writing about the frames, about the sets. Why is that? And I did not have an answer because I had no idea why I wrote about a water tank while they were in a car. Why am I writing about the water tank in the background? I had no idea. But when I was watching the film, they were in a car and there was a water tank in the back which had water in it, obviously. And she had so much inside her to tell to the guy sitting next to her, but she was not able to. I felt like she was the water tank. She had so much inside her, but she couldn't say anything because of the circumstances. And there was a water tank in the background. So somebody thought of that. Somebody decided this is going to be the road where you see the water tank in the background. Who decided it? That was the fun part for me. And that's why probably when I wrote the paper, it was mostly about the tree, the benches, the room, the colors. It was a black and white film. There were no colors, but there were shades of gray. And in the more gloomy scenes, you would see much more contrast than you did in the happier scenes. So someone out there is deciding all those things, because even if you don't notice it, they kind of, while you're watching the film, they're setting the mood for you. You don't realize that it's happening, but it's happening. And that's why when you enjoy a scene more than you do for another scene, that's probably because everything in that frame came together for you. It will not connect with everyone, but there's someone in that whole crowd who will see what you did, not on the actors, but in the background. So that was what I think was my first step into this. I didn't realize it. It happened. It was on paper. And he told me that I see beyond the actors. Maybe I should explore that option. And it just so happened that around that time, our college had renovated and they had given a bodyguard permission to shoot in our college. So the entire crew was in the college and they were shooting an extensive portion of their schedule in our college. So they decided to take some interns from the college itself to help them out with the production. Like, you know, get props from your room and give it to the actors who are playing college kids. Give your rooms to them or help them source out very basic things for a production. So our teacher asked us that we can go and talk to them and apply for different positions in different departments, which they were filling out very quickly. Since Ajit Dwara had already told me, I thought I'd just go and apply in the art department as art intern or something. And I did that. I did work with them for the schedule as an art intern on bodyguard. That was probably the first time that was my opening to the industry and how it works, because when you're watching La Ventura in a classroom, you think of something and then you are on bodyguard set, then things are different. It's about just managing whatever you have with a certain amount of money that you're given, and it's probably not going to be like a La Ventura. So it disappointed me. I was like, I'm not going to do this plastic shit. I'm not going to do this. This is not what theoretically I saw to be happening, and I was not happy with it. So I went back and I thought that, okay, fine, this was my stint and I'm done. And then Priya Suhas happened to be in the college at the same time. We had made new studios and Symbiosis was renting it out to people in the industry. That was a channel for them to get industry people to come to the campus more often and probably interact with the kids and get some placements happen. So she was making a set in one of the sets, in one of the studios that we had. That was the first time a studio, a set was being built inside Symbiosis. And I went, I met her. Then I saw she was the only person who was running the entire set while it was being constructed. And at the same time, she had started propping. Like when a set is being constructed, there's so much dust and carpentry work going on that you always have a prop table, which is right outside the set. So she's the person who's running from the table to the set, propping the entire thing alone. It was a huge house, which was a duplicate of the house that Kareena Kapoor and Saif were living in Kurban. She was propping it, and I just went up to her and I told her that if I can help her. She was quite curt and she was like, who are you? I am just a student from this college. If you want help, then I can do this. Then she was like, what do you know about this? I said, I don't. I really don't. You tell me if you want any help, I'll do whatever you want me to. She said, but do you know, have you done this before? I'm propping. Do you know anything? I said, you're doing a kitchen. I can do the kitchen. My mom has done it. You know, I've seen it happening all my life. I can set up a kitchen. It's a kitchen. So she was like, okay, fine. She probably thought I was one smart mouth and needed a lesson. So she was like, okay, go do it. So there was another friend with me, Jugal. And she was like, Mani, kya kar rahi, pagal ho gayi. Then we were like, chal, let's do this. He got bored after a while. And I finished the kitchen. And after I was done, she was like, okay, fine. I'm going to have a meeting with Shahad right now, Shahad Ali. So they were having a meeting, pre-shoot meeting on the set. And she was like, just wait for me. I want to talk to you after. So I waited. Then she called me after and she just gave me the script of Dirty Picture right there. And she told me, I want you to come join me on Dirty Picture. That's how it happened. Yeah, it was filmy. It was so filmy. And after that was that happened, obviously my professor, she spoke to me and then I spoke to her. And I asked her if we can make this official and maybe send out an invitation for other people in my class who probably want to join, like I did. And we did a series of interview where we had come and then how the rest of the things happened. I came to Bombay right after college. I joined, I was here on April 16th, 17th. I started working on Dirty Picture. And I worked with her for a couple of years and then the rest happened. So in film art direction, the first step when, I'll tell you how it works, the entire thing, and then probably I can tell you on each step where a person is hired and what skills are required for that person to be hired. Does that work for you? Yeah. Okay. So a film is conceptualized by a person, and probably the person who has conceptualized the film is either the writer or the director or someone else who has thought about the film. But it is written, it's ready to be sent into production. So the stage where we are, the production designer is hired, is where they start talking about the look of the film. But sometimes it's also before. They already have a mindset about how their film is going to look, because if you are going to direct it, you obviously have so many impressions that you already see your characters in. So the production designer and sometimes the art director, they have meetings with the production designer and the art director. They go through script readings, multiple if necessary. And then they go from, usually they talk about the most important set, the hero set, usually the slang in the industry, the hero set. It's necessarily not for a male hero. It's just the most important set in the film. So we go from there. We start talking about that. And he tells us, the director will tell us what is his vision for that set, if it's going to be a set. Then we discuss every other scene and how the look is going to be, which is the first meeting is about what is his perspective or her perspective, the person who's going to direct it most often. Then we go back and we work on the vision that he has already presented to us. The production designer's job is to decide or to visualize the entire look of the film, keeping in mind what the director has already visualized. The art director's job is more or less the same, but in the hierarchy that Bollywood works in, production designer will visualize the entire film with the art director, and the art director's job is to make that vision a reality. Like, to make it happen, you need people to do it for you. You'll visualize it. Like, suppose, for example, I don't know if you have seen Kabil. Kabil, Tamasha. How many people have watched Tamasha? How many people have watched Kabil? Okay, Tamasha. So, for Tamasha, the last scene, the grand opera that happens, that's a huge set. It was built in Mehboob. So when we first went into the initial readings of Tamasha, which was 2 years before, actually, before the grand opera was shot. So that's when we first went into the meetings. At that point, we had never thought we want to make a set for grand opera. We had thought we'll shoot it in some beautiful opera theater in London or maybe somewhere in Europe. That was the first idea. So basically, we went through the shooting of the entire film, never really thinking that we're going to come back to Bombay and make a set, because Imtiaz in general doesn't want to shoot on sets. He loves real location, so where he can make his own changes and then shoot a film. He's not very comfortable on sets generally. So we had never thought that we'll make a set. But towards the end of the film, we had finished every schedule, we had shot every scene, and Grand Opera was the only thing left. And then it was decided that we are going to do it in Bombay, because itna sab kuch, whatever we had decided or discussed or we went through the scenes, because once you go through the entire film, that was the culmination of his journey, Ved's journey. So while shooting, because when Ranveer comes in and he becomes Ved, he will bring a lot of things with him. So while watching him do Ved, become Ved, there were a lot of things which were happening obviously in the director's head also. And things kept adding to the whole idea of why are we doing grand opera. So it became very complicated every day. Before, we just wanted to do a play where we just show that, okay, fine, you know, now he has become a play director, playwright, whatever. But the flashbacks of the kid in the entire film became so important in the storytelling, in the way he was telling the story, or the way he was going to, he decided to edit the film, that he decided that the stage will have to have all the flashback memories. So that means if there were 7 stories, there were going to be 7 windows. Okay, windows will come in. There were going to be 7 stories on the stage while he's performing. This addition happened much later after we had entirely shot the film. And at that point, we still had an option to go to some opera theater in London, because the sizes are good there. The design of the place is much more beautiful than what we can get here. But at that point, the money also comes in. Getting a 100-something crew to London, stay there for a month, make a set. Our direction team will be 50 people or so. They'll go there, build a set, people will stay in a hotel. That expenditure was going to be so huge that that plan was cancelled. We stayed back here, we made a set inside Mehboob. We built the entire theatre with the seats and everything. The VFX made the ceiling and the back wall. But before they made the ceiling and the back wall, that was designed by us on 3D design softwares, where we made the design of the ceiling and the back and the theatre seats, everything, all the views, 360 degree views. And we made the seats, the platform, the stage, everything on the stage, the sides. And then the rest of it was done by VFX. So that's how it works sometimes, because nowadays we can do so much with computer that things have become much more available in terms of visualizing. The size of the studios are sometimes not enough for the vision that you have, because this grand opera set needed to be huge. It needed to be so glorious that he could prove that he left engineering or whatever, and he's doing so big, like he's become so big. That was the whole point of doing grand opera, that he succeeded in the journey that he had set out upon. So if you have seen the film, you must have seen that he started from a nukkad, right? He started telling stories to 7 people. Then he goes to performing in a small little room with maybe 10, 20 people. Then he goes to a place like this, where we have 40, 50 people. And he has a little setup with wheels turning and he's a robot. So that was a transition that he wanted to show. And the transition had to culminate in something which is grand. So that's how we ended up making that set. So going back to where I started from, production designer, art director, meeting happens. We talk about it. We hash it out completely with the director, come back. And then we start visualizing or creating visuals from, say, references or our memories, sketches, 3D designs. We start making those. So at that point, there are 3 or 4 people who are added at that stage. They're mostly people who are experts at Photoshop, CorelDRAW, AutoCAD, 3D softwares. That's where those guys come in, the people who are experts in computers. So my job at that point is to take the references, the discussion, the visions, and sit with these guys, the computer experts, and make visuals. The visuals that we are going to take back to the director and show them. Because if the production is going to spend money on something, they need to see. Nowadays, they need to see before it even happens. So we need to make designs. So that creates creates jobs for, say, about 4 to 5 people at that stage. So if you're good at any of this, Photoshop, AutoCAD, CorelDRAW, I think that could be your opening to join an art direction team. Because that is a skill which you spend a lot of time learning. People have done courses of 2 years or 3 years to learn some of these softwares. So if you enter a team with this skill, that makes you much more stronger than people who don't have those skills. That I have seen. Because after you start working, you'll never have time to learn AutoCAD. I have tried. It doesn't happen. Like, you'll never have enough time. So, but if you know these softwares on which designs are made, that's like a big hurdle already, you know, you've passed. And the rest of it, if you have the vision, if you have the aesthetics, if you work on a film with a production designer and you have been designing on the computer, maybe one day, if you show him potential, him or her potential, like suppose he's asked you to, he'll give you references, he'll sit with you, he'll tell you, ye line yahan se karo, phir ye color yahan dalo. He's telling you everything, you're doing it on the computer. But you will get that one chance where you can tell them, you can suggest something which he or she will probably like. And then that's the point where he starts thinking of you more than just a computer designer. And that's your opening. You ask for a chance to be on set. Watch the set being constructed, the set that you helped design on the computer. More than often, they say yes. Because they want to cultivate more people who are more wholesome. And in times of need where they have more than one film happening and they don't have enough assistance, the day will come where he will be like, listen, today you don't have any work in the office on the computer. Can you come to the set and just make sure this happens? And you are on set. That's where you start learning how a design on a computer turns into something on set. So once you start going to the set and you start getting involved with the people, so basically the expenditure that goes into making a set, suppose the budget is, say, 40 lakhs for a set. Most of the time, 20 lakhs will go into labor payment. It's always almost half the labor payment of every set. So when you get to a set, make sure that you spend as much time as you can with the workers, the carpenters, the painters, the molders, the tapists who sew, and welders. Because these are the things that if you start learning from the day one, if you sit with them, if you look at them, how they're doing it, that opens your mind up. And maybe if you're interested in getting to the end product and the place where you are probably an art director or something, if you have the knowledge of how things are working from the first level, how this frame is made, how this wood is attached to another metal. So these kind of things will train you better to understand how you can make a set later if you do end up there. So spend as much of time you can with the laborers that are on site, the workers that are on site. And any chance that you get, you try and give your opinion, because I think if you look, I think nobody is ever going to die just because they said whatever they thought. Or nobody is going to lose a job. Even if you did, maybe the job was not worth it. Your opinions matters. Everybody's does. Even the carpenter assistant, who, if he thinks that this measurement is not correct to add to a platform, and if he says it, maybe he saved the day and you didn't even realize it. So tell whatever, express yourself, tell whatever you want to tell, share your opinions, because sometimes we are in a box where we have decided my set is going to look like this, it's going to be painted red, and then there is this intern, she comes up and she's like, listen, maybe a burgundy is better, don't you think? My first reaction would probably be like, no, it's decided, it's okay, just let go, we are decided, done. And then I go back and I'm like, maybe red works, maybe burgundy is better. So I make a little swatch and check it out, and it does work better in the tungsten light. So that's where the intern scored a point. So the next time you're like, finish your college and come back to us. So that coming back automatically makes you assistant art director. That's usually where you start. As from assistant art director, you can obviously graduate. It takes maybe 2 to 3 years. Sometimes it takes more than that. But if you get the right film, the right production designer, and it works out, everything works out, and you've already learned everything, and they want to give you the opportunity to be an art director, they will. If they don't, they won't. You know, but this is how you get to at least assistant art director. Once you get there, it's all about hard work, learning every day, and proving yourself that you know what you're talking about, understand the aesthetics, have opinions, and you can maybe have an input which helps the film. And if you have all these skills and you can design a set, then it just up and up and up. Production designing and art direction are not different, but in our industry, that is a hierarchy. Right now, I'm an art director. I'm a freelancer. I'm an independent art director, but I've been working with Sumit Basu, who's a production designer, and he is one of the most sought after, or he's been around for a very long time. He's won Filmfare for Bhag Milkha Bhag, and I've been working with him for last 3 years. Highway was my first film with him, and then I did Lekaram Diwana Dil, then I did Tamasha and Kabil. Now I'm working with him on Thugs of Hindustan. He's one of the nicest people that I've met in the industry, and I have seen him giving opportunities to people who probably other production designers won't, just on the basis of he's not old enough, she's not old enough, she doesn't have enough experience. And I think I got like majorly lucky, because I had only worked for 3 years as assistant art director, and he gave me my first film as an, I didn't even know I was the art director of Highway. I finished the film, everything. I was just one person with eight as in like two carpenters, two painters, three extras, like that. So it was just me and those eight people, and we did the entire film, and I came back to Bombay. He wasn't there on the film. He had taken up the film, but I was traveling and I was doing the film. So when I didn't even know I was the art director of the film. I came back and then he introduced me to someone like, this is Manini, my art director. That's when I realized, okay, fine, okay, I'm the art director of the film. So, yeah, so it was a surprise and it happened. And after that, it's been very nice working with him. So to sum up, you are either from an interior designing company or an architecture company, school, or you have studied art direction in some school, or you are very good at designing softwares. these are the four things that are sure shot entry tickets to this field. And if you aren't, then if you get lucky, get on a set and get into this department, learn on the job like me, struggle, lot of struggle. And then, yeah, it works probably sometimes. It did.
Most of them are students, and if they want to be art directors, if they want to assist, what do you think would be the starting salary per se, project wise as in month wise?
Okay, that's the trickiest and the saddest part. When I started off on Dirty Picture, when I was placed, I was promised a certain amount, which I was happy with. In fact, it seemed like, oh, okay, this much. I didn't think that. But when I started working, it all changed because she had something in her mind. But more than often what happens is for new people, for interns, for assistant art directors, it's mostly per day payment or per shift payment. So when in a film shoot, like for Dirty Picture, we were shooting, say, about a week in a month. So that's 7 days of work. So whatever my per day was just into seven for a month. And surviving in Bombay with that kind of money is very difficult. Very, very difficult. My first 2 years in this field were horrible in terms of money. And if I didn't have the father that I have, I'm from a middle class family. Somehow my father made cut down on his expenses to fund mine in Bombay. It was difficult. It was very difficult. The money... But in fact, there was a point where while I was working, I'd already done Dirty Picture. I'd already worked on Ishq in Paris. And I'd already worked 11 months on Once Upon a Time in Mumbai. I'd done all the research because that was going to be a huge site. We were going to make a mini Bombay inside Film City, which had all the major areas from Mahim to Crawford. So... I had done all the research, we had made a miniature, all of that was done. So I had worked on it 11 months, we had gone to Oman, shot there. That schedule was over. And then I realized that the money that I'm getting is way less than someone on my post should get. Because I was handling shoot. So assistant art directors have different kinds of jobs. There are always, if it's a small film, there is maybe one person on set while shoot is happening. Their job is to protect the frame. Whatever is there in the frame, you look at it from the point of view that the entire film has been designed and you make sure that it is correct. And then there are other assistant directors whose job is back ends, you know, set up the next set or go buy props or get some printing done. Or get some posters designed. There are lots of different kinds of jobs when you are an assistant director, and you will probably be given one department or other. But that doesn't define that that's going to be your responsibility for the next project. It's just that how work is divided. And it turned out that on Once Upon a Time, I was doing all this alone because she had hired two new people, and one of them was from London. She had no idea what the market was. I was doing all of that because you're from... So this is where so you grow up in a middle class family, you go to different schools every year, and you're always told that if it's not difficult, you're not going to get it. Like everything that you do in your life has to feel like huge pain, otherwise future is not going to be good. So in my head, I kept thinking, since this is so difficult, I don't get to sleep. I am on set from 7 o'clock to 9 o'clock at night. Then I'm at the printing house from 10 o'clock to 3 o'clock in the morning for almost a year. That means I'm doing my job. And I never thought about the money. I was too shy to ask other people that how much I should earn. So I made roughly 25 to 28,000 every month for the first 2 years. And that's not how you should be paid. So I spoke about it and I left the film after 11 months because I was not okay with that. I packed my bags, I got tickets for Bhubaneswar, where I'm from. And I decided I'm going to do something else because this industry just exploits you like crazy. And maybe I'm not in the right place, maybe I can maybe develop some other skill and do something else. Because in the beginning, the plan was not this. The plan was to go to National Geography. So I packed my bags. I was ready to leave. I quit the project. And then Nikhil, who is sitting here, he knew Sumit Basu. They were friends. He had done the behind the scenes for Rockstar and Cocktail and all of that. And he was friends with Sumit Basu. And he knew him. So he just asked me to give him 3 hours. And he got me on his bike. At that point, he had a bike. And he dropped me off at Acropolis, which is Sumit Basu's company's name. And he called him and he said, there's this friend who has worked as assistant art director for 3 films. And she's looking for a job. Can you meet her? And he the way he is, he never says no. I said, yeah, ask her to come and meet me. At that point, I met him. I had no idea I was going to talk about highway or I was not even in the mood. I just went to meet him because he made me. And then we sat there in his office and we spoke for 5 hours straight. And he kept asking me, if this film was offered to you, how would you do it? How many of you have seen Highway? Okay. So when Alia is kidnapped, for example, she's taken to this house, which is a Gujar house in a Gujar village. So that was his first question. He was like, I'm not going to tell you the entire story, but so there is a girl from Delhi. She is kidnapped by Gujars and taken to a Gujar village around Delhi. And then they're in a car, they get out of the car and they go inside the house. And it's just a very simple shot. And he showed me the photograph, one photograph he showed me of a house, random house. That was not the house chosen, just a random house in a Gujar village. And he was like, what would you do to this location where you think you can give an input to the film or add to misose? Misose is something which everybody in art direction will have to know because that's your bread and butter. Even if you think that nobody is watching beyond the actor, it is important to set a frame or help them set a frame which tells the story of that moment or maybe the moment that is important or the moment that you want to establish while the actors are doing their thing. So he asked me what would I do because there was just a wall behind when the car comes and stops. And I told him I would probably paint a Pushpak Vimaan and I'll probably paint Ravan taking away Sita. That's what I would paint on it. That's how we talked about the entire film. We just talked for 5 hours and then he hired me for Highway. So we had already discussed, he knew what my plans were. And I have totally forgotten why I am telling you this story. Money. So at that point, he didn't know if he can afford me because he had already hired 2 people. And I was not in the mood where I wanted to work in Bombay anymore. So I just talked with him about Highway. I told him what would be my take on the entire film. I went back and then he offered me an amount which was not much higher than what I was getting. But I still took up the project because intiazali, you know. So, and all of that came with it. And the story was beautiful on paper, beautiful, absolutely amazing. So he did give me the script or to read, you know. So I said yes, and the money wasn't much higher, as I said, but I still did it because sometimes you just pick the correct film. That film has done this. Like I'm standing here and on a mic, I'm telling you what I've done in life. That film did that for me. Highway. So even if that was less money, it gave me good returns. Before that, I was doing something which was almost equal money. It was not giving anything back. I was not getting anything back. So money is very subjective. The struggle is also subjective. Is it worth struggling for? Is the money worth it? Then go for it. Do it. Because at the end of the day, if you've made the right choice, if it's the right project, right people to work with, it doesn't matter if you're not getting paid also. So that's my take on money.
And the reason why I asked you about money is most of the students out here from communication background, like we had, you know, we want to make a documentary, we want to assist directors, or sometimes if we are very keen to be behind the camera, maybe assist the cinematographer in that case. We don't think about art direction as you did, and it was also accidental.
Yeah.
But everywhere, every project that they take, even if they join a news broadcasting this thing or a radio or anywhere, the money would be initially same in the media and entertainment industry.
Approximately.
You know, until unless you become a Ranveer Singh or you become the celebrity. So that struggle will always be there. But if you have this...
Can I add, another thing? I am an art director right now, but I get paid lesser than every other art director right now in the industry because I don't have experience. So that also comes back. There's a huge factor. I don't have enough years behind me to ask for a certain amount, but I'm happy with what I'm getting. So yeah, so that's something that you can't fight. It's just how it is.
Yeah, so most of you, when you go and when you apply to different companies, you know, the initial bracket would be between 20 to 30. Anywhere, if you're lucky enough. Sometimes even less than
yes.
that. It's like 10,000 as intern. You intern for 6 months, and like she said, if you make those right inputs, then you get to work on further projects, and your salary is hiked. So don't keep money as your main this thing while choosing your company or while getting your job. Think, are you going to put in that much effort? A very important point which she said, hard work. It's a very simple word, hard work. But Manini, I don't know if you remember or not, the first project I did when I came to Bombay was Everready Ad.
Yes.
So I worked in that project for 7 days, 5 to 7 days. I was staying at Malad. I had to go to Trombay. How many of you know where Trombay is?
You have to know your city.
How,
there's no way out.
How far is Trombay from Malad? Any idea? Yes.
But
so
back now you have metros. Back
yeah,
then
yeah,
we
back
had
back
to
back
take auto, change to
yeah,
trains,
so
and then
Malad
get there.
To go to the station also, I had to think I have to take a bus, not an auto. I couldn't take that.
Yeah, we couldn't afford
yes,
auto.
Yes.
Yeah, buses,
and,
yeah.
You know, initial 7 days, first time in Bombay, you don't know anything. You don't know the train. So you call up your friends who have been working in Bombay, because you can't call up Priya Suhas. Hello, ma'am, how to come to Trombay? You can't do that. So you go there, and the shifts used to end at 2 o'clock in the morning. In those 7 days, I have slept at the studio twice because I knew I can't go to Malad and can't take the pain of coming back. So at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning, and next day is due to start at 7 o'clock. I couldn't carry on. One of the reasons being the project which I was offered, it got delayed or they didn't require anyone. But hats off to Manini, guys. Let's have a big round of applause, because that's the hard work she goes through every day. And I'm sure all her assistants and everyone, they go through the same hard work. So don't think ki boss mujhe to padhel jana hai, train pakad ke nahi lunga, 20,000 mein kya hoga. It's not about that. I mean, if you have that thing called passion, which Vivek would put a lot of input, just go for it. It's 3 hours, 4 hours sleep, doesn't matter. You have to struggle. That's why you are here in this industry. You're not, you have not studied biology, you have not studied chemistry to be an engineer, to be a doctor. You are in the media and entertainment fraternity, and that's the challenge. Even if you want to assist a director, you understand art direction is not everybody's cup of tea. But if you crack it like her, good enough. I mean, she's still cracking and she's bagging good projects. Brilliant projects, not good project, brilliant project. But for every director, there will be 10,000 people to assist him. So there is a struggle there also. How to be his 5th, 6th, 7th AD. The 7th AD maybe probably doesn't even go to the sets.
No, it doesn't.
Ya phir jaake continuity dekhte hain. If you know what the continuity is in a film. Or dress, there are costume ADs. So you just manage the costume ki agar aaj Manini is wearing this, and if the shoot is, they stop the shooting today, they come back after 2 months. Sometimes it happens. Manini has to, wear the same clothes. You can't have continuity errors, and that's very bad. Some people look into the camera while the camera is there. Some people look into the camera like this. The next shot, you will see the head that side. That is continuity error, guys. So there are a lot of people behind the camera doing all these things, but to get those jobs, it's very, very tough. Similarly, to do something like an art director, like she does, is very, very tough. But the struggle, if it, at the end of the day, if it counts, it counts.
I've made 40 films, and unlike any other producer, Manini, I've made 40 films with 40 debut directors. They were not directors who were born in the industry. They just became friends because they loved movies, and then, sir, I want to make a movie. So I have never made a film that I wanted to make. I've always made a film because somebody needed to make that film or act in it, and I had to make it, otherwise that fellow would not have got a career. So my first film, Gawahi, where I had a budget of only 5 lakh rupees, and I went to Zeenat Aman and I told her that Shekhar Kapoor was working free, and then I went to Shekhar Kapoor and told him that Zeenat Aman was working free. And then I went to Tanuja and told her that Shekhar and Zeenat were working free. I got the whole cast free of charge. I then got caught on the first day of shoot when all of them, including Vikram Gokhale, Ranjita Kaur, it was a big cast, got together and realized that they had been conned by this fellow called Vivek Vaswani. I was summoned before the first shot. And being a smart producer, I did the most sensible thing. I sat in front of them and I cried. And I was really cute. I was in Khandan and I was this really cute kid 100 years ago. And I wept my heart out. And then Zeenat was bringing food from her house for me. And Tanuja was giving me a lift back home because otherwise the poor boy would have to go by bus. Gawahi got made. It was my friend Anant Balani's first film. He had come from the Film Institute. He needed a film. It was my friend Deepak Sehgal's first film as an editor. Deepak had also, he was in the same batch as Anant Balani. And Deepak had married Bela Bansali, who is now Bela Sehgal. And she was the assistant editor. And I don't even recollect having an art director because we didn't have a budget. So Anant and me would go to SL Studios with paint and polish. And we sort of cleaned up this courtroom set that was there. And I made Zeenat Aman wear her own clothes. That she has never forgiven me for. And we went onwards to a film called Patthar Ke Phool, in which we launched Raveena Tandon, whom you've heard of. And the assistants on those films were Sanjay Gupta, whom Manini has done Kabul with, which is why we are connected. And Ashutosh Gawarikar, who was the hero of Gawahi, because he was the only, and he was the only one who got paid 700 rupees to act in it, because he was assisting and he said, I have to be the hero. And so we said, okay, you know. And he was this strapping lad with this huge afro. Now there's no hair, but he's still Ashutosh Gawarikar. And Sanjay Garvi, who made the Dhoom films. Aditya Chopra has always said, you launch them, I'll use them, which is okay. And Umesh Ghatke, who made Kya Cool Ahem Part 3 later, for your Dirty Picture producer. And I can't remember. This was Salman's first film, actually, because Maine Pyar Kiya released when I had finished shooting 7 reels of Patthar Ke Phool. By then, there was this fat little kid called Shah Rukh Khan, who I met on the road, and he wangled his way into my house, and he was living in my house. He lived there for 2 years, and we had to make a film for him. And Anand Balani said, are you mad after making a film? Because Patthar Ke Phool became this huge hit. So obviously the financer GP Sippy and Anand Balani, who was my director, and so on and so forth, they figured that Salman and Raveena and Anand, it would be the same combination moving forward, except that this boy is living in my house and says, I will not budge until you make a film for me. So Raju Ban Gaya Gentleman was born, which was Shah Rukh's first film. I didn't allow it to be his first release because we had to make him saleable before my film released. I really didn't care about the others, but my film should be a hit. So we had to use our brains. And it was also Jatin Lalit's first film. It was Aziz Mirza's first film. And my art director there, I had an art director finally on my third or fourth film. I graduated to having an art director, who was this rambunctious man called Gautam Sen, if you've heard of him. Used to drink heavily, and then he used to sit in, because I needed these paintings. I'm a South Bombay person. I have a perspective on how a film should look. And Gautam would sort of But then he saw me sitting in the studio till 3 in the morning while he was doing everything, and he finally realized that this is not one of those producers who comes in a car for 10 minutes. This guy who's sitting on the set and eating pav bhaji and sitting with him. So we became friends. And he had this very timid assistant art director called Sumit Basu.
Oh my God.
Who never, I didn't hear him speaking one word on the set of Raju Ban Gaya Gentleman. I just didn't hear a word from Sumit. But whenever we wanted things, it was there. I had a new director, Aziz Mirza, who had no clue what to do. He used to sit down and eat samosas. And I realized that it's because Shah Rukh loves him that we've got him to direct. But this man is going to just say action and cut and go home. So Shah Rukh and me have to make the film. It was only smart that we would get the best technicians for Aziz. Vinod Pradhan shot the film. Renu Saluja edited the film, Gautam Sen was the art director, and Jatin Lalit were new, but they did a marvelous job on my music. And well, we won 4 Filmfare Awards for Raju. Meanwhile, Mr. Sanjay Gupta was ready with his Aatish, and he was able to get Sanjay Dutt, because Sanjay Dutt had worked with him when he was assisting on a film called Thanedar. So, and of course, Shah Rukh was already, so Sanjay Gupta comes to me and says, sir, you know, I had promised, I mean, you've already made Shah Rukh into a star, but there's a friend of mine from college, and if he can get a break, so his name is Atul Agnihotri, so good old Atul got launched in Aatish. Kooli number one was born when Ramesh Torani of Tips, who's superstitious, called me and said, this is my friend Vashu Bhagnani, and he wants to become a producer, but he can't produce. So I asked the logical question. I said, why does he want to be a producer if he can't produce? So he said, no, but that makes no difference. I don't know how to create music. See, I'm running Tips. I said, but your Tips stood up because Patthar Ke Bhool had good music. He says, that's why I've called you. Now you make Kooli number one. So I made Kooli number one and launched a producer. By which time I was worn out, and after Patthar Ke Phool and Raju Ban Gaya Gentleman and Aatish and Kooli Number One, I just took 2 years off and did television, where I got a whole bunch of my theatre friends like Tanaz, Kareem, Lal, now Irani, and Keith Stevenson, and Hosi Vasunya, and Viju Khote, and Shubha Khote. And for 3 years we did Zaban Sambhal Ke, we had fun on television. Everybody Says I'm Fine was Rahul Bose's first film as a director, Rasool Pukati's first film as a sound recordist, Homi Adajania's first film as an assistant director, Anahita Shroff's first film as a costume designer. They bloody got married, Homi and Anahita, really. Boman Irani's first film as an actor, as well as Rehan Engineer Koel Puri, Anahita Uberoi, who was in school with me. And we went to Zakir Hussain and told him to do the music, and Zakir had never done a film before. And Zakir wanted Carlos Santana to play the guitar, so we went off and kidnapped him from his house, and we actually made him play the guitar. We got things done. I've never had money, and I've never made a film I wanted to make. But I guess more than making the films I wanted to make, I've always given a chance to the kids I wanted to. And of course, my last film, because for the last 5 or 6 years I've been teaching, I work with kids, I work with orphans, I work at Shamak's with the wheelchair children. You will not believe how great they are as dancers. They can't walk, but boy, they can dance. And I do their career counseling, I do English, I do film history. And obviously, you know, if you see my history, which I've just told you, from Gawahi right now up to here, and I didn't think I'd make more movies, but I made a film called Rough Book, on which I became the art director because there was no budget. Rough Book didn't have a budget, and Tanishtha Chatterjee worked free, Ram Kapoor worked free, because somewhere along, I can't remember in which film I made so many, I had launched him, a new boy called Aman Khan, and it was easy for me to say, don't worry, I have an eye, I'll do it. As she's proven, it's far more difficult. But to cut things short, I just went to Symbiosis and I shot. So everything that Mani's gone on, I've already gone on that road before, which is a wonderful coincidence, because she's told you exactly how it is. She has told you the nice parts. I started at 50 rupees a day. And no matter how many hundreds of years ago it was still not enough. of course, it was advantageous in those days to be living in Cuffbridge and having taught, being taught in Campion School and Cathedral School and so on and so forth. What was tough is that my friends, my parents, nobody not only saw Hindi movies in those days, they were quite disdained. The moment I said I'm going to make movies, I was the outcast, and I still did it. Being an outcast, you can too. It's not that difficult if you have the passion. I will repeat before I call Manini and we do a great question answer session what I said the last time I talked to you, those of you who heard me shouting. You don't have the passion yet. Because I'll do the same exercise for those who are here for the first time. How many of you are here for the first time? Okay, so first 10 people. So the guys who were here before, don't answer, but for them to understand what I'm going to ask, it's very important that you people don't. And how many of you who are here because you have a passion for cinema? Truly you love movies. Truly you love movies. Truly you want to be part of cinema for the next 40 years as your profession because you love movies, and you know, okay. Liars. How many films has Yash Chopra directed?
14.
You can't do guesswork like this. No, you can't do guesswork like this. How many films has Raj Kapoor directed?
10.
How many has he produced? Finished. It's over. I asked that question the last time, so you all remembered, and you all quietly went into Google and checked how many films he had directed, and you forgot to see how many films he's produced. That's passion. Really, truly, if passion is not translated into knowledge, then you're not passionate about cinema. Don't even say, how many of you watch movies? Really good. I'll prove that also. I'll prove that myth also. Which is the last film you saw in the cinema? Dear Zindagi, who was the sound recorders of that film? Did we see the titles? Did we read the titles? No, we went as any common audience who pays 200 rupees and then tweets. Rubbish movie. But if you have passion and if you want to be part of this industry and if you're going to go into a movie and you're not even going to read the titles of the movie, then why should I believe you have passion? I threw an open challenge to those who heard me speaking the last time. I said, I don't want to see whether you are a good actor or a bad actor if I cast you, or whether you're going to be a good director, or you're going to be a good producer, or you're going to be good any. Answer any three questions that I ask you to prove that you love movies enough to stay here. Any three questions I ask you. Normal comments, I'm not asking you what did Raj Kapoor eat 3 days before he died. I'm just asking you how many films the man produced. I'll sign you on a three-film contract and pay you a crore rupees between the three films. I've said it before, but you can't. Is that the film industry's fault? No, no. There are good producers like me. I've launched half the industry. More than half. I don't know. Everybody. I don't care. You want to prove to me you have passion. You can't answer three simple questions about the film industry. How do I trust that you will take yourself and your career and therefore me, my film, my company forward? How do you prove that to me? I'm not asking you for money. Aditya Chopra is not saying sleep with me. Somebody is not saying tie up your family fortune. I'm not asking you to be Amitabh Bachchan's son. I'm not asking you to be Rakesh Roshan's son. I'm not asking you to be Randhir Kapoor's daughter. I'm saying if you're passionate about being here for the next 40 years, prove it to me. I'll sign you on a contract now. But you can't.
I can prove.
Sure. Stand up. Name the 40 films I've made.
I don't know who you are, sir.
There you go. Sit down. No, no. You have to prove it to me. I don't want you to prove it to the universe. I'm the one who has to pay you, no? Isn't that fair? You don't know who I am. It's over, no, at some point. So, rule number one. You can't talk with me you can't work with me. But that applies to Adi Chopra, and that applies to Boni Kapoor, and that applies to Imtiaz Ali, and that applies to Shah Rukh Khan, and that applies to Ranbir Kapoor. You can't talk to Ranbir Kapoor, whose grandfather Raj Kapoor's cinema. You can't work with him. He's not interested in you. He loves movies. You can't tell Mr. Ranbir Kapoor about Rishi Kapoor's movies and which films he's done, which was his first film. You don't know how many Filmfare Awards Bobby has won. You don't have the knowledge. But it is that knowledge which analyzed gives you your strategy. Not a general template, but your specific strategy. That strategy, when you use for yourself, like she did, Manini did, and she survived Bombay, becomes into a plan. And when that plan is based on knowledge and facts, you have control over the situation. And when you have control over a situation, you have power. And power leads to success. I didn't create the rules, the universe did. Is it so difficult? In my days, I didn't have Google. We didn't have cell phones. I would go from cinema to cinema and learn the posters by heart. If I ask you where Gopi Cinema is in Bombay, you don't know. Does anyone know where Gopi Cinema is? How many cinemas are there in Bombay? We all want to be part of cinema. No? No? No, no. We're way off. It's in hundreds. But that's not the point. You see, you can't become successful with guesswork. So rule number one, when you meet a person like Boni Kapoor or Aditya Chopra or Imtiaz Ali or Sumit Basu, if you can't talk with them, you can't work with them, if they can't communicate with you, if they can't build a rapport with you, if they can't love you enough because of the platform that you have, which is common, which is cinema. What will you talk to them about? You see their movies, you don't read the titles, you don't know how many cinemas there are in Bombay, you don't know how to translate your career into a successful, profitable situation. Where are you going to go? I may be completely wrong. Let us admit. But if you look from Shah Rukh Khan to Mukul Dev to Iqbal Khan to Boman Irani to Ashutosh Gabarikar to Rasool Pukati to Kiran Devhans to Jatin Lalit to Aziz Mirza to Rahul Bose, I know what I'm talking about. None of the people I launched were even remotely connected to the film industry. Sure. They had the passion, maybe they didn't know, and maybe nobody told them, because this is not taught in your Whistling Woods, etc., that your passion for your work has to translate into knowledge about what. What is the second proof of this? I have friends who are completely passionate about cricket. Completely mad about cricket. They know everything. They know who Tendulkar is, they know his wife's name, they know his kid's name, they know what the name of the stadium is in Bombay, they know what the name of the stadium is in Kolkata, they know what is the name of the stadium in Chennai where cricket matches are played, they know the names of the teams, they know the captains of the teams, they know how many wickets were broken in. They know! And then I have friends who have passion for cars. They know everything about those damn cars. They know about what is the difference between a wheel. For me, a car has four wheels and a steering wheel, it moves. Sometimes it doesn't move, then you take a taxi. But those who have a passion for car, 30 different kinds of wheels, 14 different kinds of decals that can be put on the car, so many models of BMWs, what is a four-wheel drive, what is a six-wheel, or whatever, they know. It's the one big takeaway that you have to take from here is that if you genuinely have the passion for your work, for cinema, for whichever stream of the industry that you want to get into, your passion will automatically and obviously translate into knowledge. It should. If it isn't, you have to analyze very carefully what you're doing that you didn't think of, or maybe you didn't know, maybe you didn't care. But that is your individual, personal, introspection that you have to do so that you can move forward. After making 40 films, I realized I wasn't a producer, I was a teacher. It happens. You can always go on one path and change. I mean, no one's going to stop you. It's a democracy still, I hope. I don't know, but it is. So I learned a lot from Manini when she spoke today. We are all learning all the time. And I learned so many things that for the first time, I have a whole bunch of questions that I have, which Manini will answer. And which is why I told Dipankar, I said, I will take the second session and I will lead the question answer session. So the first 3-4 questions I will ask Manini, and then I'll throw it open and I'll moderate your whole question answer session. And not only Manini, me, we will answer everything that you were afraid to ask anybody else in the world. Manini? So could you first clearly define for us here, what is a production designer and what is an art director?
Sure. I actually touched this subject while I was talking. Basically, the production design, here it is about the hierarchy mostly. The production designer is the head of the department of designing. Their job is to visualize the entire look and feel of the film, the entire project, film or the ad film or whatever it is, TV serial. And then the art director's job is to take that vision and make it into reality that it is.
Oh, so the execution is the art.
Yes. And if you're lucky, like me, like I have been since last 3 years, I get to participate in the visualizing process. Sumit Basu has always let me in from the very first step, and I have always been allowed to be a part of the visualizing process also. So yeah, so if you get lucky, you get...
Why are you saying if you are lucky, other production designers?
I have worked with other production designers also, and most of the times that you are not included in the process. And your job is only limited to executing their vision. But yeah, some people, there are a lot, actually, in fact, there are a lot of new young production designers in the industry now, and they let you be a part of the visualizing process, which is actually very important. The sooner you get to participate, I think my growth happened so fast because he let me be a part of that visualizing process so quickly in the in my career. If that wouldn't have happened, I don't think I would have landed up here so quickly. Because if I have to compare myself with other art directors in the industry, I think I have, that's why I call myself lucky.
See, who will be the higher head to the production designer? The producer or the director? It's a different department, I think.
The producer is the person who takes care of the money and the logistics.
The producer is the owner of the ship. He owns the ship. The director is the captain of the ship. Now, if you actually take the analogy of a ship, the owner may be sitting on land somewhere in London, in Greece, in India. But the captain is on that ship in the sea. So even though the ship is owned by the producer, when they are at sea, the ultimate and final authority will always be the director or the captain. If there is no emergency and if there is a difficult decision, a director who is sensible, who doesn't have an ego, will pick up the phone and talk to the producer and say, I am in this quandary. Do I go with your budget, for example, or do I go with my vision, for example? And if there is a sensible producer, then they will sit together and they will work out the best way forward. That then, the decisions made jointly in a good situation between the producer and the director will trickle down to the DOP, will trickle down to the production designer, through whom it will trickle down to the art director and to every other person involved, because finally it is one team of people making the film. But in terms of hierarchy in this particular department, I think the department would be headed by the production designer, because the vision of the director is first given to A, the production designer, and B, the director of photography. You know? So I want to make a film. I want it dark blue. I want, it's a film that is set in England in the winter. I have certain textures which I as a director see in my mind. I'm seeing slow, I'm seeing dark blue skies, I'm seeing. Now this is what I'm seeing as a director, this is what I'm putting on paper. Now the first person I'll sit with is the production designer and the DOP and say this is what we should do. Now they will give me the inputs. It's all very well to say London in the winter, but we can't shoot, it's -6. Let's find a viable option. Then the brainstorming, and then through that, they will work on that.
Okay. Who all works on the production designer, art director, costume designer?
Sorry, I couldn't.
Who all works under production designer, art director, and costume designer? That's it, right?
Director of photography. Whatever they do, he has to.
Oh, you want to know the HODs, all the departments.
Heads of department.
The first line of HODs after the director would be the director of cinematography, the DOP. Production designer, the costume designer, the sound designer, because now we are making sync sounds, and then you have editor, the music directors, action directors, and those are the basic departments. But now you have a lot of new things coming in, also the VFX supervisor. Those are the basic ones for now.
I have one question. Does the production designer also give inputs to the costume designer or only to the art department? Because if he's looking at the whole look and feel.
If I have to answer it from a theoretical point of view, like we see in Hollywood, the production designer is supposed to be a very important part while deciding the costumes. Because when, apart from the main characters, if suppose you're looking at a market set, so you have a lot of junior artists in clothes. The clothes will have to go with the set. So since set is a background for people, the production designer needs to be involved in the designing of costumes as well. This is how it works outside. In fact, there are a lot of production designers in Hollywood who are also costume designers. They do both the things for the film. But here, sadly, that process is not the norm, but things are changing. Sumit Basu, for example, he had an equal amount of say in the costume in Bhag Milka Bhag and plus in Mirzia. So things are changing, and I can only tell you from the experience that I have had or people that I know have had. So, I see it happening around us, and people have started talking to each other now and discussing it on one platform where they also sit together and decide colors and mood and everything. There is the other side of it, which I experienced in my first film, which I was actually telling someone this story right now. So, there was a set where Vidya Balan is on the stage and she's accepting an award and she's giving a speech, and the set was designed in primarily red. And she ended up coming to the set in a red dress because the costume designer and the production designer were not facilitated by the people to sit together and talk about it. You know, it is as simple as that. That thing did not work out for the entire frame. It did not. It posed a lot of problems. They couldn't use a lot of long shots because she was blending with the background. So they played with a lot of closer shots and a low angle and top angle and all of that. And they only had one or two long shots while she was leaving the stage or when she was getting onto the stage. So that those kind of problems happen when you don't talk to each other.
But the director would have known.
So the director has ADs. There are ADs who are... given each department, like costume, there is an AD who is handling the communication between the director and the costume department. There is another AD who is handling the communication between the director and the production designing. Now, if those two ADs don't talk to each other, then problems like this will happen.
Does the budget follow the vision, or does the vision follow the budget? It's a very difficult question because, and I'm asking this specifically because, and I'm using the example of my old friend Imtiaz Ali. On a tamasha, you said that, they followed the vision. They decided they would put up a set at Mehboob Studio, whatever it cost, because it would be cheaper than going to London and putting up a set. I'm just giving an example. But on a highway, there was no budget. So I'm sure that your vision had to, and as you were traveling through this entire thing, you had to make shift, make do with what you had. Of course, it was an outdoor film, so there was a lot of things that, like when I shot Rough Book and Symbiosis, I used what Symbiosis had to my advantage by being sensible. But generally, on a big film, like Thugs of Hindustan, the budget would follow your vision, or would your vision have to be within the parameters of a budget given to you?
So when a film is conceptualized and a production house or a producer decides to make a film, I'm sure you first look at the kind of returns you're looking at, and you have an idea about this product can get me this ballpark of a return, right? So according to that, the producer has already decided itna hi kharcha kar paunga, usse zyada nahi, correct? So based on that, sometime more than often, we are given a kind of a rough idea. Is film ka isse zyada budget nahi ho sakta. So we need to plan accordingly. But then you work on something like Thugs of Hindustan. It's a huge canvas. It's a huge film. So in those kind of films, you have the liberty to give vision the bigger priority than budget, and they are doing everything in their power to make this film probably the biggest canvas that we are ever going to see.
In fact, I must tell you, for those who don't know, that Thugs of Hindustan is being produced by Aditya Chopra, and it stars Amitabh Bachchan and Aamir Khan for the last time together. I don't think they'll work together after this. All things said and considered, considering that they make one film every 3 years and stuff. But, okay, the first time together. But when you have Amitabh Bachchan, Aamir Khan and Aditya Chopra, who's a man who's always had the vision. He's the one who called me up and said, give me Shah Rukh Khan, Aamir has walked out of Dar. I don't mind going with this new boy. And he also called me up and he wanted Sanjay Gadhvi for Mere Yaar Ki Shaadi. That man has vision. He's quite, like Sumit Basu, he doesn't speak too much to outsiders. But when you have Aamir Khan and Aditya Chopra and Amitabh Bachchan together, you obviously have a film that has the bandwidth she's talking about, which is why she would be given the best facilities. But yet, it's all about spending, not wastage. So
yes.
Talk to them about that.
Before that, and then there was highway. They did not have money. That was very clear from the beginning. Most of the things that you see in highway, for example, inside the truck when they're sitting, there's everything. It's like a makeshift house inside that truck. So the only big expenditure in that film was the truck. We bought a new truck and we completely dismembered it. We took out everything except the machine and we built our own parts and put it on it. Because it had to facilitate the shots they had already planned. And that was a good thing about highway. The shots were on paper. And for example, there was a shot after Alia gets molested by one of the characters. She's claustrophobic and she's leaning and her head is on the side of the truck. But they needed a little bit of light to fall on her eyes. So we made a wall for the truck which had holes in it. It became a part of the design. That's how the entire film was designed. Because the shots were on paper, we could design and make a truck which facilitated every shot that was designed. And after the truck was done, highway, it was very different in the sense that I had bought everything. There was a prop list because every scene they're traveling to new places. So we first had a recce where we traveled like they are traveling in the film. We have taken cars and we have gone from one city to another and we have traveled on the road. We traveled for 15 days and my job was to stay at every stop that they stop for 1 to 2 days, look at the surroundings, meet people, talk to them, see the villages. And then I came back to Bombay, we made the truck, then I went back and I had bought everything that I needed for each and every scene. Then I went to villages, I went to houses, met women, exchanged my new things for their old stuff. Everything that you see in highway has come from someone's house. So if I needed her patila, I bought her a new patila, I got her an old one. Because the film had to be as realistic as possible. And no matter how good my painter is, the patila is never going to look like a patila which a woman has been using for last 10 years. So I did that. For every village we stopped, I went to houses, exchanged my stuff. And that worked out for the budget also. There was this one random incident. The truck had to have a lot of props and it was a sync sound film. Now every prop that you see inside the truck was lined with rubber. Every wall was lined with rubber. The flooring was lined with rubber. So even if you stepped on the truck and you jumped on it, it didn't make a sound because they only needed the sound that was necessary with the design. So if you need, in one particular scene, if you needed the aluminium mug to make a sound, like touch the other utensil, so we would remove the rubber from that utensil only and we would take the shot. The truck would move and it would make the sound and everything else has to shut up because he had to take it, the sound had to be recorded in layers. For me, that film was, it was like doing a course in our direction. So when budget, you don't have budget, you just have to look outside, ask for help, exchange things, get things from people. That's how we make college films, how we make our own short films. That's how you have to do it. One day I was on the highway and I was buying some parandas and ribbons and all that for my truck. And then I see this truck driver stop at the same stop and he came out of the cabin and he was drinking water. He had a huge Sprite bottle, you know, that 1.5 liter bottle. He had that Sprite bottle. The truck had a number from Rajasthan. So that was probably a Rajasthan truck passing through Delhi. I was shopping in Delhi on a highway somewhere outskirts. And then I saw the bottle from a distance. That bottle had vinyl design on it completely. He has gotten it printed somewhere. And full Rajasthani folk art was done on the Sprite bottle. I ran behind the truck, half a kilometer, made him stop, gave him new bottle and got that bottle. So that bottle has been there in the frame when you look at it. If you ever watch the film, that's my favorite prop in the film. So, yeah.
So I must tell you about my new film. It's called Take Off. Again, there's a new producer, a new director, a new actor. And it's about one man who's stuck on a luxurious Learjet, private jet, and the pilot is dead and the air hostesses have been murdered and the murderer has parachuted off the plane after locking the cockpit. And poor Mohit has to spend his time breaking the jacuzzi and breaking the cockpit door and getting there and trying to, land the plane with its broken craft without killing people. And there's a bomb on the plane as well for good measure. My budget is less than 1 crore, I must tell you. And we're going to do it. I don't know how yet. I'm already putting my mind into how I can put up this huge set of this plane and do everything. But one thing I've got, I went to Mehboob Studio and they quoted some 1 lakh rupees a day or some ridiculous usurer's amount. I went to one air-conditioned studio in Mud Island and I conned them into giving me the studio at 2 lakh rupees a month. Yeah. That's how you make films.
Okay. I love sitting and talking to people about highway because that's completely that experience of scratching at everything that you have to give something that people are going to just be like, wow, we didn't even think this was possible, is amazing. It's so much bigger than having so much money because you have returns and I can ask for anything. I can ask for anything and it will be given if it's justified. Let me tell you, I can't just like go around spending money. If it's justified, I'll have it. But in a film like Highway, we wanted to do so much, but we didn't have money, but we were just scratching at everything to make do with whatever we had. Like we went to Aru to shoot the last sequence and that was the Pahadi people, they live in small mud houses and they had one mud house which had perfect location in terms of light for Amit, for Anil sir and for Imtiaz, but it was a tabela, the horses were living in it, so it was a dump inside and it took 3 days to clean it. And it was a 45-minute trek from Belgaum. So we would trek every day, clean the place up. And we turned a stable into their house. and we got the village people to help us. We got the stuff, the props from the village people. So this experience, I can't compare it with sitting in AC rooms and laptop and prop vendors, call Usman bhai, send me 3 chandeliers. That's fun, but this is different. So there's no choosing between a highway and a Thugs of Hindustan.
But I'm really talking about zero budget. I mean like zero, literally
zero. If I have a way to pay my rent, electricity bill, I will do a zero budget. If I have a way to.
So you won't be charging
it? That's what I'm saying, that if I have money in my account to go through say about 2 months, I will probably, if I love the script and I want to do it, I will do it. It's all about one. It's about you selling me that. If you can convince me to live without partying for 2 months and eating outside for 2 months or spending money on my clothes or my, I don't know, movies. If you can convince me with your script, I will do it. That, yeah.
You have an historian with you, helps you in guiding you on all this, or just to let you do it?
The script was written by someone who is being advised by a historian. So for us, the script in terms of people and how they spoke and all of that, we depend on the script for the scene. But to make sets for them, we do our own research. And this film has been in production, in pre-production for last 1.5 years. People have been researching in each and every department for last 1.5 years. So we depend on the books, the interviews, the pictures, museums, everything. We go through all of that to make sure that we have got the history correct. But
so yes. I would like to ask you then, on a film like this, you obviously need a proper storyboard. So is the storyboard done by the production designer and given to the director, or do the direction department make a storyboard and give it to you, because or do they collaborate on it?
They collaborate on it, and there is no two way about it, because the director has to decide how he wants to play out the scene, and the production designer will help with designing the scene.
What if the one who are you're working under, he has an ego, like you're telling him something and he's like, why is this guy telling me, like, tera aukat kya hai, like, why are you telling me this? What if that happens and it'll cost you your job or something? Like, when will you like know that if I should be asking him or telling him this or not to tell him? Like, is there a way, or like, it depends on him?
That's an individualistic point of view. You will decide, they will not decide. You will decide where you draw the line. If the moment you let someone else decide for you, that's when you start losing. What can you take? How much can you take that you will decide that? And how much is your opinion worth? If it's worth fighting for, fight for it. If that person listens, and if you are right, maybe you are right. If you are right, you probably help that person, even if they're shouting at you, screaming at you, telling you to just not say anything. But if it works out at the end of the day, that person will realize you are right, and the next time the fight will be easier. So you decide. Don't let someone else decide how much. Don't let me tell you, acha listen, do gaali ke baad chale jana hai. Right? And we can only hope that we meet people who are open-minded and who have space in their lives to accommodate our opinions.
How do you decide what props you have to, choose for a film?
For me, when you start telling me a story, I see everything in visuals. That's how I have always been since I was a little kid. If you tell me main train ke piche bhag raha tha, train nikal gayi, mujhe platform hi dikhta hai. So, wo person to person depend karta hai. If you're telling me something, I see it in a visual, and I think most of my design or most of my aesthetics is based upon my experiences. Everybody's experiences are so different from each other, so their aesthetics are different from each other. So I think it's very important to travel, to read, to watch, to listen to people, to learn about new experiences. You can't... My father has a transferable job. He got transferred every 2 to 3 years. I've I've lived all over the country, and I think that helped me a lot in accumulating different varieties of taste. So according to my taste, I design what I want to put in the frame. And Sumit Basu employs any production designer, for example, Sumit Basu has employed me because he thinks my tastes matches with his taste. That's how it works. And sometimes someone, being good or bad at your job or a creative job is subjective. Maybe my taste is good, but someone doesn't like my taste because it doesn't match with their aesthetics. Things, differences like that will always happen, but don't let it be a problem, because there are so many different kinds of people with so many different kinds of aesthetics, and maybe someone is your niche. That's what you have to find. That's the struggle also. Yeah. It depends on where the story is taking me, which era it's based on. Where is it based? Is it a Bombay story, Delhi story? Where is it? It all depends on that. Who are my characters? Being blind changes everything. If you're a blind person, then you need to imagine a life where you can't see, and how your house will be if you can't see. So you can't have these set patterns. I think that's what we are trying to break, all of us. Because hum log na, if kya hota hai, if main 10 saal se dekh raha hu ki jo rich aadmi hai uska ghar aisa hota hai, if we keep doing that, we are not gonna go anywhere. Because there are a lot of rich people who don't live with golden swans at their staircases. They don't. So that's where experience and adventures, knowing people and talking to them, or just going back to books again. It's an everyday process of learning.
Do you want to become a movie director?
I think that's what we started off with, right? Like, we all wanted to be movie directors. That's why we had joined Symbiosis, him and I. And I figured out very soon that I was much better at art direction than I would be at direction. So, I think
wanted to be a documentary
director. Yes, I did.
But with Highway, you almost did the same thing.
It felt like I was part of one, yeah.
So, Mani, I have one question. You are called by your production designer, the director, and everyone. When you guys are sitting together, especially for outdoor shoots, will you be an important person to assist the production designer and the director to recce, to go to different locations and to give him your feedback? Maybe, you know, Rajasthan's highway would work rather than any other highway. So, would you make that decision, or would that decision comes from?
Our director will have to be on every recce. It can't happen. Because the production designer, they necessarily are not on shoot, or while the entire filming process is going on. It depends from film to film also. If the film demands more people to be involved at every point, then they will be. But usually they are not there. And that's where I come in. I am always there for you. And secondly, it also depends on, Imtiaz was a person who would ask the driver also if he thinks this road is good enough to shoot. So it depends from person to person. And with Imtiaz, we were lucky that all of us could stand. Like, we were, say, about 10 people, all of us could stand and talk about it. Everybody's opinion was welcome, and that's why it was such a fun experience to work with a person like that. And yes, if I could make a smart input, I'm sure people who have common sense would accept that it's smart and probably use it. I can only try.
Actually, last night itself on YouTube, a little short 20 minutes, the making of Fan. And I was astonished because when I saw Fan in the cinema, and there was this whole section where Shah Rukh Khan goes to this European country by a private plane, and then he goes inside this huge Baroque hall, and there's a Sindhi wedding going on where the other guy creates havoc, and then he's insulted by the host. And I say, yeah, you know, he's a big star, nobody's going to insult him, but he's virtually thrown out of that wedding because, you know, he's misbehaved with the groom or bride. You remember that whole scene? And I said, they must have gone to this country, whichever it is, because they must be getting a subsidy from this country. Otherwise, why would they go all the way there? And then when I saw this making of all of it was done with green cloth, and all of it was, that plane was digital, the car was digital, the house was digital, the staircase was digital, everything was digital. And it was so realistic that even, you know, I mean, we tend to look at, if it's done badly, we can see it sticking out by a mile. But if it's done well, like it was done fine, even I thought they had possibly. So, it must have been cheaper than either putting up that set at Mehboob or going to Croatia or Uzbekistan and shooting it. But is it possible on all films, or do you think this is something that's going to take its own time to develop in terms of the kind of levels of quality that you all will demand?
In Kabul, we went outside to exterior location twice. One was the sea, the second one was Imagica. Everything else, whoever has seen it, from bandstand cremation to Nariman Point, everything was inside a set. Hrithik Roshan did not want it to shoot outside. He was more comfortable shooting inside. There was so much action sequence, we couldn't afford to be in an outside location because A, it's risky. Two, you can't control it.
It's a controlled environment.
Yes. So from under construction, we have built inside Filmistan Studio Number 3, we have built two stories of under construction building. With Kabul was totally green. It was completely shot. 95% of it was shot in front of green chroma. So I think...
But those sets were designed by you.
Yes, I call him Dada. Sumit Basu and me. So that's how it works. So now the thing is that virtual studios would probably, demand for virtual studios is increasing every day because it makes shooting much easier. You don't have to worry about crowd. You don't have to worry about parking your vanity. And let me tell you, those are all very important things.
Permissions
and shooting hours. When you're shooting outside, you're chasing light all the time. When you're shooting inside, you can go on to shoot for 12 hours, 13 hours, 16 hours. You can do that. And I think that saves a lot of cost as well. But yes, you end up spending a portion of that saved cost in keying the green out and putting whatever you want to. And if you have good technicians, you get good products. Kabul, most of the scenes, you can't, even his house was inside a studio, the under construction building, everything. In a couple of places, you can tell, because it has not been keyed out properly, but in a couple of places you definitely can't. So technicians, the VFX department's work is very important, and gradually in our country the level of skill is increasing. Yash Raj has its own VFX department, it's called YFX, and Prana, Prime Focus, yeah. So yeah. So that's the future, where the future is, and I think people who are investing in making these studios are very aware that it is.
It's a virtual set of, it's a green chroma, but how it's different from anywhere else is, if you want a certain location of Corsica, our image scanner guys would go and scan the area, and the keying will be done live. So that's the difference. Yes, so you can see, you, yes, now, yeah, now my question is, what you as an art director, what will be your input in such a scenario? Does it increase your work, does it decrease your work, challenges and everything?
We have to, when we are shooting with chroma, the color of your set is majorly governed by how you are, they're virtually going to light it. So that's where, that's the tricky part, and we haven't really excelled at it yet. We don't understand it properly yet, and we are trying to every day. And I've experienced the troubles in recently when we were working on Kabul. But yeah, it's
skin tones, right?
Yes, the skin tones. So lighting becomes very crucial, because if you don't have enough distance between your, that's another thing. I don't know how big your studio is, but for example, there's a Nariman Point set in Kabul. The chroma, we were limited by the budget, the time, the actors' dates, and the availability of the studio. We got a very, we did not get a correct size of studio floor for the dates that the actor was available, so we shot in a smaller studio. The chroma was only 15 feet away from the set, and that is absolutely the most horrible place that you can be, because no matter how much permutation combination the DOP does with the lighting, this is just too near. So that's why the end product, when you look at it, at Nariman Point, that scene, you can tell that it's not been shot. It has been shot in front of chroma. So yeah, all of that you need to obviously calculate and see how it's going to happen. Plus, every scene has a priority level. Like for an action sequence where Hrithik Roshan is fighting off the villain in an under construction building, the priority is safety. So we can't shoot in a real under construction building. So then there is no option. It doesn't matter what where I am comfortable. The priority of every set is different. For example, when we shot Imagica, you can't make Imagica inside a set. You have to go to Imagica. For the cremation scene where he's cremating his wife, he did not want to go and shoot in bandstand because you can't control crowd. You have to shoot it inside a studio. So these kind of factors decide where you are, how you are shooting it. Not what I prefer, not what the production designer prefers. These, the more logistical and maybe like the entire way that the director is looking at the scene. Like he said, if you want to shoot in Bindi Bazaar, you can try and make it inside a set, inside Filmistan, maybe take a ground and make a Bindi Bazaar there. But obviously, you're not going to get the same flavor, no matter how much you try. The expanse of it is so huge. The location that you're trying to copy, the expanse of it is so huge that it's obviously you would like to go and shoot in Bindi Bazaar, but it's not easy to do it there. Like thousands and thousands of people. How do you control them? And if you have a famous actor, you can't do it.
Now I predict in the future, there's going to be enough touts, for want of a better word, who are going to have 800 pre-planned, pre-shot Gateway of India, Apollo Bandar, all this ready. Police station, temple, mandir, garden, lake, mountain, tree, and you're going to say, okay, give me a tree, I'm going to shoot in a tree. This is. Well, everything depends on budgets. Finally, it comes down to everything depends on budgets when you are making a film, which is. And especially for those who. And I'm not talking of B grade films, I'm not talking of all those films, you know, Lion, Tiger, Sher, Cheetah, Panther that we make with incredible, punctuality every month. I'm talking of independent cinema, which does require a certain amount of aesthetics and which never has money. Aesthetic, and for the kind of cinema that people like you, me and her would love to give our life for without money, never has enough money. Those are sometimes the options that you would use only because you didn't have the money.
For a period, if you are shooting on a particular location, we're looking at maybe 30 years behind. And today the same road, 30 years later, looks very different. So do you need to take help of VFX a lot to remove certain things?
Yeah. We do. So the things that we can change manually, we do that. And the things that we can't, like for example, a billboard at 20 feet height with a PSA on it, we can't touch it. The government won't let us. So we get VFX people to change the advertisement on the billboard.
So you need to show a frame of that to your VFX guys even before going further?
When we shoot anything like that where VFX work needs to be done on an outside location, there is a VFX supervisor who's always present on the set. They take plates, something called plates. They take plates of the entire location, 360 degree plates, and they go back and they match it with the camera lens that the scene was shot with. At the shoot stage. Yeah. And then later, during post-production, they just put the plate in.
In the olden days, I started with advertising. We used to always say, when you don't have anything, put a plant. Does that happen?
It still happens and I hate it.
I hate it too. But what do you do if you don't have the budget or anything else to put in?
For example, we were doing a film called Josh, and somewhere Mansoor found this wonderful old, very old Volkswagen Bugs. You know Bugs? Yeah. It was really old, but belonged to some old Goan gentleman, and he had kept it in absolutely pristine condition. It was glowing. It was glowing, bright red. It looked as if it was new, but it was about 45 years old. My buddy Shah Rukh Khan jumped on it and cracked the paint and the bonnet. Luckily, the old man was having his morning siesta because he was really old. We didn't know what to do and we needed it. So, and it was a scene with me where he's with Priya and I'm running and they're running after me, or well, let's have a race or something like that, and it's mine. And we painted a yellow flower on it. It's still there, see the film. And we painted the yellow flower on it. We shot our scene and then we left production to face the music with the old man. That's a smart thing, you know. Don't be in production, be in art department. But you have to use your brains at the right time. You know, we couldn't possibly put a potted plant on that.
Suppose a film like Martian, which is shot in completely inside a chroma hall with a rig, how would the art direction work in that?
The plates that will be put later after you are done shooting in front of chroma, the plates will be designed by a production designer or an art director. Even if it's on a computer, their input will be there. And plus, in front of the chroma also, he is inside the spaceship, right? So that was made. That was made, portions of it. We'll have to make that. And then we have to design the rest of it on a computer. And someone in VFX will match it up, give it a background, which will also be chosen by the director and the production designer, the DOP together. Films are all about collaboration. Otherwise, it's one department cannot decide everything for a frame.
Also, for your reference, I was talking about on YouTube the making of Fan, the making of The Martian, and another very important chroma film, Life of Pi, which was shot in a tank, actually, you know, with a tiger and a boy. Suraj was a friend of mine. It's all on YouTube. The making, the art director talking, the production designer talking, the DOP talking, the director talking, how they set out, what kind of problems they ran into. There's a whole wealth of knowledge there if you people just start pressing buttons, you know.
And very accessible also.
It's just pressing buttons. You don't have to walk from theater to theater and learn posters by heart the way I did. You just have to press buttons on your phone and just watch all this. It's all there.
There was this sequence in Kick where a body has to fly through a video wall. So for a sequence like that, which is majorly VFX, because obviously an actor cannot, we can't hurt an actor. So, or anyone, we can't hurt anyone.
Actors you can hurt, stars you can't.
So,
stunt takes care of it.
No, nowadays people, because VFX has become such a accessible department, and people and their skills have increased and we are more dependent on that. So now body double requirement has decreased a lot, and there is action team, rigging and all of that, so it works. So we have like 20 foot by 20 foot ka video wall, and we decide ki yahi pe lagne wala, the body is going to fly at this angle, exactly at this position. So what I do is cut out that much portion, so the person flies through the hole, and in VFX they put the hole and the shreds of glass, which will be separately shot in a smaller frame. There'll be glass shreds which will be broken through an invisibly kept bomb underneath, and then we get glass shreds separately. Then you get fire sparks shot separately. Then you get the actor fallen down on the ground on the other side. You put the fake glass and everything, the parts of the TV and the wall, whatever. And then the actor has landed on the fake debris, and you shoot that separately, and then you stitch everything together. So that's how the VFX portion of it works, and that's where we come in. Because providing the elements for a VFX to create an entire sequence is our job. Yeah, and plus the thing is that if it's going to be shot 360 degree, that means your set will have to be majorly removable. All your walls will have to be easily movable. Like, you don't need this wall, right? So your design has to change. Your material will have to change. We'll have to create a set in which the elements of the set or the walls of the set can be easily taken out and put back.
So it's a lot more research.
It is. And a lot more work and a lot more expenditure.
Like that one moment which you or your team couldn't figure it out and then you all cracked it.
For me personally, Tamasha, I think we had finished shooting most of it and only the last set was left, which we put up in Mehboob. And between that, I had an accident, lost a ligament, and I had a knee surgery. And so I couldn't walk basically. I was on crutches for 8 months. And I had to put up the Grand Opera set while I was on a crutch. So I would put up a chair at the center of the set and I had a mic. This is the only time I've used mic on set. Okay. I had a mic and I made that set on crutches. And that was difficult physically because our work generally involves a lot of walking around. And for me, what worked was the set was around like a circle. Everything I could see from one point, so that helped. But I was limited at my space. So that was a big problem, I think. And plus the production designer, he was doing Mirzia at the same time. He had taken up Mirzia and Tamasha at the same time. And his team in Mirzia was a fresh team, so he had to stay there. And here I was handicapped, so that was tough physically. And in terms of art direction and being tough, I think Kabul, because I had never done a full-fledged action film before and I had no experience to fall back upon. And it was an out-and-out action film and everything was inside set. So every day I had to learn something new to provide things to them, which they could have probably gotten in a much easier way from an art director who has already done a lot of action film. But for me, it was every day I had to learn something new.
Most of the movies that I've seen shot down south have got one thing in common. Everything has to be done quickly. Even if you're proposing a girl, it has to be, I love you, you love me too. There is not, I love you. There's a lot of action. Everything happens very quickly. So there are too many scenes in a movie with respect to a normal movie that is shot in Bollywood. How does your job change then? I mean, as an art director, if you have more number of scenes to handle, then more number of sets in play. I mean, how does this change from one industry to the other, although both of them are part of the Indian
film? It doesn't. Your job is not defined by the number of sets you're putting. Your job is defined by how you're putting it and if it works for the film or not. So I don't think it'll change. It doesn't matter if they shot 40 scenes instead of 4 scenes or it... I mean, it really doesn't. I do not care how long it is being shown in the film until a point where the producer tells me, listen, I can't spend more than this much because I'm showing it for 4 seconds. Then I go back, revise my budget, work on my prop list, work on my construction material, and I give him options because it's his requirement. It's his lookout to make sure that he's spending a proportionate amount according to the time that he's going to show the set. But I will not think from that perspective. I will only make changes if he asks me to.
With that, we come to the end of our masterclass. Here at Media Connect, I would just like to point out a few things. Media Connect brings up with these fabulous masterclasses. We just had one with Manini Mishra. Let's have a big round of applause. So, in masterclasses, we are not here to, you know, get the celebrities. No. You all have to learn about all these aspects as well, whether you want to be an art director or you want to be a director. You have to learn these, learn about her experiences, learn about everyone else's experience and with different aspect, like we can call a sound recordist and what all he goes through. So we will be covering the entire spectrum. We'll try to cover as much as possible and it's going to be free, but only if you're interested, please come down. have your seat, you know, like these guys are, you all can also sit on the staircase. But apart from master classes, we are also starting, we have also started off with other things, like you can find your projects, you can find opportunities at Media Connect, you can find jobs at different offices, different organizations, AC rooms where you can start working at, you know, advertising companies or as a graphic designer. So all these opportunities are there, and you as media students, it's very helpful. Like Vivek said, you just have to press those four buttons, and if it's very tough, then maybe you can try some other ways to find a job. So opportunities, masterclasses, we have started something called Prima, which is for PR students. What we are giving is, we are giving every PR student an opportunity to manage a celebrity. Now, it's not easy. Today, Manini, to us, she's also a celebrity, because after this kind of stature of work, you know, she stands out and she has a lot to give to you guys. So she's a celebrity. Vivek Vaswani is a celebrity, and there are other people who are connected with Media Connect. So you all can manage a Vivek Vaswani, you all can manage a Manini Mishra, you can manage other people, provided you all start managing a friend who wants to be an art director, and maybe he is working or she is working on any film. Director who is making a student film. So start promoting them. If we see that your body of work is good, we will help you out with the celebrities. And you know, these adds up to your CVs as well. It is all about those exposure. And only when you get into this path of taking these exposures, taking these opportunities, you will see, like Malini did, she went inside and she said, I'll help you out in doing the kitchen. That was a starting point, and today she is. So you all have to take that step. Even if you are an advertising student or communication student, take this step. Ask your actor friend who wants to be an actor, hey, I will manage your profile, can I do that? He wouldn't mind. Manage his profile on Media Connect. Learn more about it from Anmol, or just call us up anytime. Apart from that, we have something, a program called Kickstart, where we are calling companies and we are asking you all to come. So if for example, we are calling 3-4 PR companies like an Edelman and other PR firms, you all will come, whoever is interested in PR, and the amount of experience and everything that they are looking at, if your CV qualifies, you all come and you all stand up in front of them, and that's the platform that we are giving. So there are a lot of things that we are doing. We are going to different colleges. We'll be going to MIT as well. On anyone from MIT here? MIT? Yeah. So we'll be coming to your college on Wednesday. We will be conducting a session on Media Connect and Prima, and we are going to different colleges. Like, we are going to other cities as well. We are coming up with a lot of platforms, a lot of things. So stay connected on Media Connect. And finally, I would like to ask Mr. Vivek Vaswani to hand over a token of appreciation to Manini for sharing all the wisdom and all her words with us. And Manini, you're not a freelancer. To us, you're an entrepreneur. You're managing your own team. So you're not a freelancer. So this is a huge service that you are doing for us who like movies, for others, aspirants who want to. And today you have opened the door for everyone to look at movies if they want to. Whoever was interested, there are people we can see who are half dead, cozy recliners and everything. It's okay. But whoever want to take back something, I'm sure Manini has shared a lot of things. So please stay connected on our Facebook page, on our Twitter, on Media Connect platform, and please reach us out if you have any question. Again, Manini, if you're looking for any interns, after you come back in the month of Jan, and if you think, you know, someone can come, just let us know. We will give you the right candidate if possible.
I think what you guys are doing with Media Connect is amazing. Because he would also tell you, every 6 months, maybe we're always looking for someone new, some people that we can't even reach. Because, yeah, there are Facebook pages and all of that where we put up our advertisements, but it always doesn't get responded back. Because sometimes I think people just don't think or think that they can do it, or don't think that their qualifications are good enough, or maybe they don't understand what we are asking. and you are going to bridge that gap, and it's amazing what you guys are doing. And I am so glad I came, and I hope that I could say something in the last 2 hours that I've been speaking that maybe will help someone somewhere.
I love the class. Like, I was there as a student, not as your I was there as a student, and like you mentioned, for Media Connect, we are giving most of the profiles a verification tick with a body of work. Again, when it's connected through projects that they are putting up on Media Connect and someone's applying, if the person who is putting up and the person who's applying is good enough, then he can give a certain review system. So all those things we are trying to shape up. It will take some time, obviously. 1st of April, we are going to launch in Spain and USA. We just spoke about it. So like this, we will be going to different parts of the world where projects would be created, not only in India. So these guys, you know, someone like we spoke the first time.
Yeah.
People don't know how to connect to a Manini Mishra. So maybe through this, it will be bridged, and very soon we can see Manini Mishra in a Hollywood movie or like that. That's not the benchmark. I mean, she has obviously done her body of work, but in everywhere. So that's what we are trying to build. Yeah. Thank you, Manini.
Thank you so much, guys, for being patient, and you guys were really sweet. I mean, we remember during symbiosis, we were just not nice people. Whenever people came and spoke to us, we were not